Okay, welcome everybody to our afternoon webinar session today. First of all, I want to check if everybody can hear me. You should be able to hear me. If you have questions or any issues, please type them into the chat. I'm just typing, I'm sorry. If, as said, if there are any issues, I'm trying to fix them. And that's good. I'm just waiting for a couple of participants who are still missing. In the meantime, you will receive a video of this webinar and you will receive the presentation that's shown in this webinar afterwards by mail. If you have questions during the webinar, just type them into the chat. We will answer all these questions afterwards or during the webinar after the presentation. Okay, the list of participants is quite full now. Thank you for your feedback. And I think we can start. Today's topic is thermal conductivity measurement, thermal diffusivity measurement, and of course the laser flash technique at all. Before we start in detail, I want to introduce myself. For those who do not know me yet, my name is Sebastian Seibt. I'm responsible for the service and application laboratory here at Linsize. I'm a chemist and I'm doing this since 2013 now. For the future, there's my colleague, Erika, who's the application manager for thermal conductivity, which is also the LFA. So if you have questions or need service measurements or have any issues with your instruments, you can contact also her directly. Her contact data is written over here. And for those who do not know the company yet, a short introduction of the Linsize company. Linsize was founded in 1956 by Dr. Maximilian Linsize, the guy on the picture up left. It is founded here in Selb, Bavaria in Germany. And this is also where our main facilities are and our production is placed. In the meantime, we have subsidiaries in US and China, where we have also small laboratories for testing. We have sales offices there, and we have some repair and service offices over there. In all the countries worldwide that are not listed here, we are more or less distributing our instruments by several distributing companies and distributors, freelancers, and field technicians that are all spread all over the world. And everybody of them should be able to be contacted. And in every country, wherever you are, that you can be sure that there is a Linsize distributor available. The main business field of Linsize is the production of instruments for thermal analysis, thermal conductivity, and thermal electric, and of course, DST, thermogravimetry, and so on. And on the second leg we have, or second device is we offer service measurements in our lab and service measurements for special applications, of course. We are a family-owned business. As I said, we were founded by Dr. Maximilian Linsize, the guy up here. And in the meantime, we are third generation. Our CEO now is Klaus Linsize, so the son of our founder. And his two sons, Florian and Dr. Vincent Linsize, who are now at the moment in the lead of our company. As I said, the product range is from DSC over classical thermogravimetry and combined DSC thermogravimetric. We have telemetry, thermomechanical analysis, and thermal conductivity. Not only the LFA, but also hot plate technique, hot wire techniques, heat flow meters, and so on. We have analyzers for thermoelectrics. We have thin film analyzers for thermal conductivity, electrical conductivity, and other issues. We have Hall effect analyzers, and of course, we offer customizations. One of our main topics and main advantages is that we can build all these instruments you see here in customized versions. That means we have high pressure, high temperature, ultra low temperature range available. We can adjust our instruments to your needs. That means we can build them into a process. We can modify them to couple them with any other instrument like mass spectrometers, infrared spectrometers, and anything else you can imagine. So we are pretty flexible regarding our instrument design. I'm just off. The sound is not so good. I'm trying to fix that. Just to keep that in mind, you will receive the presentation as a video and the complete presentation afterwards by mail. I'm trying to enforce the microphone and get the sound a little bit louder. I hope that it's better now. I'm sorry for that. But that's all I can do from my side. So I just increased the sound parameters. I'm sorry for that one. As said, you will receive a video with sound afterward, then you can have a look on that if it's not fixed now. I just turned up the volume. I'm sorry for that. Sorry for the interruption. As said, the product range contains a lot of customizations. And today we want to focus on thermal conductivity and diffusivity, especially the LFA instrument. Regarding the mechanism of the LFA measurement, first of all, we have to clarify and talk about the mechanism of heat transfer. If you want to measure thermal diffusivity and thermal conductivity, you have to be sure and you have to know what you actually want to measure. So on the scheme right here, you see wherever you have hot environment and cold environment, you will generate a certain heat flow, or shortly Q, that always goes from the hot side to the cold side. No matter if it's conducted by air or any bulk material, there will always be a heat flow from the hot to the cold environment. Depending on what kind of material your heat conducting material is, the type of heat transport is different. So the general mechanisms of heat transfer are shown up here. First of all, of course, you have infrared radiation or any kind of irradiation that can transport energy and also heat energy directly. Then, of course, you have convection. If you have, for instance, a liquid or a gas, the heat can spread out just by convection, so atomic transport. So atoms can move and molecules can move, and they can bring the energy they have stored within themselves to any other place. And then the important part, you have conduction. So no transport of material, no beams, or no molecules and atoms are transported, but somehow the heat is moving out. And then you have to differ between phonon contribution, that means you have lattice vibrations, that means your atoms and molecules have a certain vibration, and this vibration is going from one molecule, from one atom to the other, and therefore forms a kind of wave that goes through your material. Or you can have electronic contribution. That means the electrons within your material may be free and may be able to move, and then they can transport the energy in form of electronic transport. And now, depending on what kind of material you have, it depends. As you see, if it's metal, you have electronic contribution mainly. In metals, usually the electrons are freely moving. So the electrons transport the heat. In insulation materials like plastics or ceramics or rubbers and so on, the lattice vibration, so the phonon contribution, is the main part. And then, of course, most materials are a mixture of this, or just semi-metals, semiconductors, or anything in between. And then both parts are possible. That means if you want to simulate heat transport, thermal diffusivity, thermal conductivity, it's very hard to predict which kind of transport mechanism is the dominant part and how much electronic contribution, phonon contribution, maybe radiation and convection you will face. So therefore, simulation of thermal conductivity and theoretical calculations are very inaccurate and very hard to do and to perform. And that is the reason why the measurement of thermal conductivity, of course, is very important. And by the way, down here you see the equation. So the heat flow Q is described by a temperature difference divided by the distance the temperature shall be transported times this factor lambda. And this factor lambda is the thermal conductivity you want to measure. Just that you know what you basically do with these instruments. So how to measure the thermal conductivity? As said, there are many instruments. Today we will focus on the LFA later on, but there are also other methods. On the scheme on the left side here, you see an overview about thermal conductivity range and temperature range and what kind of materials you typically measure in that range. First of all, there's the heat flow meter. The heat flow meter is a hot and cold plate instrument that has a certain range from minus 20 to plus 100 centigrade. It's pretty narrow, so the temperature range, temperature-wise, is around ambient temperatures. The heat flow meter follows a couple of standards, international standards and ASTM standards, and is mainly designed for the building industries. It is also very limited by the range of thermal conductivity. So you have a range from 0.001, so 1 milliwatt per meter Kelvin, to around 1 or 1.5 watt per meter Kelvin. As I said, it's mainly made for measuring insulations or building materials, and therefore it's a very narrow range. Typical materials will be vacuum insulations, polystyrene foams, PUR foams, fibers, fiber boards, and so on. The next instrument in the list would be the TIM tester, trans-interface material tester, which has a range from minus 30 to up to 300 centigrade and can measure a little bit more. It can measure up to around 15 watt per meter Kelvin. So with that instrument, you can basically measure thermal conductivity pastes, concrete, glass, ceramics, kind of silicons, and so on. It's also working in a kind of plate mode. You have a hot and cold plate and have a gradient heater. Next instrument in the row would be the THB. THB is more flexible but a little bit less accurate instrument that works from minus 150 to up to 700 centigrade. The range is still increased. Now we can measure up to 150 watt per meter Kelvin, and as I said, almost any kind of material. So also alumina, carbon bricks, iron, steel, copper, and so on. The THB is limited by its accuracy. Nevertheless, it's the most flexible of the easy to apply methods. And then, of course, we have the LFA technique. The flash technique is the most precise one and has the biggest range. So from minus 125 to 2800 centigrade, you can basically measure almost everything. As you see, the range is from almost zero, so 10 milliwatt per meter Kelvin, up to 1000 watt per meter Kelvin, which also covers high conductivity materials like copper, aluminum, and even diamonds. Disadvantage here is the laser flash needs proper sample preparation. It's very hard or not so easy to operate and to prepare your samples, and it's more time consuming and more expensive than any other technique. Before we start with the LFA in detail, there's one thing you should know. The LFA does not measure the thermal conductivity, it primarily measures the thermal diffusivity. Now, what's the difference here? So there's a difference between the thermal diffusivity and conductivity as follows. The thermal diffusivity, which is called alpha, is measured in square meters or square centimeters per second and gives you more or less the speed how fast the temperature difference moves through a material, or how fast the temperature difference in the material is leveled out. While the thermal conductivity lambda, with the unit watt per meter Kelvin, gives you information how much heat is transferred or how good energy transport is conducted through the material. So thermal diffusivity is more or less a speed. Thermal conductivity is giving you an energy amount. And both are connected by the formula you can see at the bottom side here. So the thermal conductivity is calculated by a thermal diffusivity times specific heat capacity times the density of the material at a given temperature T. That means the LFA can measure thermal diffusivity, and as it can also measure the heat capacity, can therefore calculate the thermal conductivity out of this equation. The only thing you need to know is the density and the material thickness, as you will see later on. So before we start with the LFA, I want to clarify why it is important to know the thermal conductivity and diffusivity at all. As said, there is a various range. And why is it so important, besides the fact that it's hard to simulate and hard to calculate? The thermal conductivity is a very crucial parameter in the design of any device or machine, especially if you have a machine where some heat is generated or some heat is evolved. Usually, you want to get rid of the heat, and you have to build something around your process that transfers the heat fast enough in an amount that you need to anywhere else to get rid of your heat. If you don't do this properly, your machine can break. There can be some heat storage or some heat evolved at the place you don't want it. And then results, like on the picture on the down left side, can be the case. You can have cracks. You can have material failure due to heat. You can have heat expansion where you don't need it or don't want it. You can have leakages and so on. And that's the reason why thermal conductivity of almost every material is very important to know. Just let me say again, I know that some people are having sound troubles. As said, you will receive a video of the webinar afterwards. I'm sorry for that. We try to fix that, but that's all we can do for the moment, just that you know that we are not ignoring that. I'm sorry. Also for quality control, the thermal conductivity can be used as an indicator for material composition. If you have a material with a certain composition, the thermal conductivity is a material constant and can be used for quality control if there is no other value or other indicator available. So that's also a possible application. Now to the LFA. The LFA method or flash method can be performed using a laser energy source or can also be applied by using a xenon lamp as energy source. Usually you have a small thin disk that is pulsed by a laser or energy pulse from one side. And on the opposite side, on the rear side, you have a detector that measures how fast and how much heat is transferred through the sample over time. To achieve that, we have different models in our program, from the LFA 500 with infrared harness for more or less high throughput, to the LFA 500 upgradable to higher temperatures, with rather focus on temperature, and the LFA 1000 that covers the complete temperature range and can, as I said, measure basically every material. From the schematics or from the construction side, they are all the same. So depending on what temperature you want to measure, you can use a laser, a real laser, infrared laser pulse as an energy source, or you can just use a xenon lamp if you stay beyond 500 centigrades. That's the reason why we name our system LFA 500 and 1000. No matter if you have a xenon lamp as an energy pulse source or laser, the principle it works is always the same. You have this green furnace part that controls the temperature of your sample in both cases. Within the furnace, you have a sample robot on both instruments. You can see them here. And within the sample robot, the samples are placed. You can load up to 18 samples in one instrument, so you can heat up to 18 samples at the same time. And then this robot turns around and brings the sample you are measuring into the beam, and the one sample that's in the beam is measured. Then it turns to the next one and so on. So you can handle up to 18 samples at the same time. As said, the samples are hit by a laser pulse, which is only lasting a couple of milliseconds from the bottom side, or from a xenon pulse from the bottom side. In both cases, you know the exact pulse duration and pulse shape, so you know the exact amount of energy that's brought to the sample. On the top side, you have a detector system that can be a liquid nitrogen cool detector or just Diode Peltier cool detector, which is looking from the top side to the sample and recognizes how much heat is released at the opposite side of the sample. Out of that, you get a measurement signal. Then, of course, you have some other parts like controller for the furnace lift and coolers and whatever, but that's how, in general, the procedure works. And now to the measurement. As I said, the detector on the top side sees how much heat increase at the top side of the sample takes place after laser pulse. So if your laser pulse time is zero, you can see here on the signal received is received by the detector. And the only thing that's of interest is the half-time rise. So after what time this peak has reached half of its maximum height. Out of that, more or less, the thermal diffusivity is directly calculated. I said calculated because it's really calculated. You have to fit this with a mathematical model, and there are different models available. The software does this automatically. And out of the fit, there's a fitting equation you see on the top right side. Out of the fitting equation, you get the thermal diffusivity alpha. Regarding these models, We are using here at Linsize, we are using a so-called combined model that considers several effects like radiation, reflectance effects, heat loss due to contact to sample holder, and other effects. The combined model can be considered as a universal model. It's named by Professor Dusa, who published this. There are a couple of other models, and evaluation models can be selected. So you can do laser shot, and then you can choose which model you want to apply. For a less experienced user, we would recommend to use the combined model. For the more experienced users, you can also select between several other published models. By the way, this is done in every flash system around the world, no matter which brand, in the same way. So the models and the mathematics behind the models are always the same. So there's no difference between the different manufacturers at that point, just that you have heard and seen that. There's also an international standard, the ASTM E1461, which describes these models and how these fits should be evaluated. Regarding samples, I already mentioned, you can have up to 18 samples within one sample holder. On the top left side here, you see the 18 sample holder, but usually we use 6 or 3 samples. The ASTM I just mentioned, the ASTM 1461, usually describes the sample as a 1-inch diameter sample. So we have this 1-inch sample holder where you can place up to 3 samples with 1-inch diameter. And then the ASTM also mentions that half-inch samples would be acceptable. So there's also a half-inch sample holder where you can load up to 6 samples with a diameter of a half-inch size. If you want to really use the 18 sample holder, it's only 3 or 6 millimeter diameter, so a square inch, but not really half an inch, a quarter inch, sorry. And in all these sample holders itself, there are these little adapters where the sample is placed, and then you can see the sample must not be a round disk. It can also be a square sample, like 20 times 20 millimeters for the 1-inch sample holder, or 10 times 10 millimeters for the half inch sample holder. Besides that, we have possibilities to measure liquids, powders, paste. So we have sample holders for liquids. We have some where you can measure in-plane, through-plane, but I will show on the next slide. We have some for powders and pastes with sapphire windows, powders and pastes with graphite lids, and many more. So depending on the application, you really need the fitting sample holder. As I said, the layer thickness of your sample is very crucial, and the density of your sample is very important to know for the measurement. On the pictures below, you see various spare parts and sample holders. So you see these robots holders with these adapters where the sample are fixed. And then you see how it's placed in the system on the right picture here. About the features of the measurement, as I said, depending on if you have the laser source or the xenon flash source, the maximum energy differs a bit. As long as you measure lower thermal conductivity materials, the smaller pulse energy does not have any effect. But for high conductivity materials, you need more power, you need more energy. And then you see at higher energy levels, the laser pulse gives you a smooth signal, while the xenon lamp with lower energy, only 10 joule or 15 joule, already has a certain noise. But as long as your material has no high conductivity, and as long as the temperature range you want to cover is not exceeding the 500 centigrades, xenon lamp leads to the same result like the laser source, and it's much cheaper. As said, the systems are modular, so you can decide between a fast infrared furnace that allows high throughput up to, I would say, 800 to 1000 degrees. You can have XFA furnaces up to 1400, and of course, you can have the laser flash technique up to 2800. So we are quite modular and quite flexible here. Regarding the detector, as I already said, you can choose between a Peltier-cooled detector and a liquid nitrogen detector. These are two times the same measurement with the two types of detectors, just that you see the result is nearly the same. So no matter if you have liquid nitrogen detector on the right side or Peltier-cooled detector on the left side, if you measure the same sample with the same settings, the detector signal and the evaluation is basically the same. The only limitation of the Peltier detector is that it also is limited by temperature. So if you want to go to higher temperatures, then I would say 700 degrees, something like that, you need the liquid nitrogen cool detector where you have to fill in liquid nitrogen time by time. While if you stay below that, you can have a Peltier cool detector that's working without any need of cooling liquid and so on. Just that you have seen this. Now, I want to discuss a little bit about applications and possible application fields. As said, thermal conductivity is very important in almost every kind of material research and construction, anything from engines over aircraft, spacecrafts, building insulation materials, raw metals, quality control of raw metals, of course, big machines, reactors, and so on, and even in space environment, we have instruments who measure stuff like satellite parts and so on. Typical fields, I divide them by materials, are ceramics. Nowadays, ceramics, besides dishes, are like parts for brakes, ceramic fiber materials, ceramic wools, ceramic building parts, fusions, and crucibles, of course. And of all of these parts, the thermal conductivity behavior is of interest. Therefore, ceramics is a broad field and one typical application I want to show here. Most ceramics follow the same principle. So they have a decreasing thermal diffusivity and also decreasing thermal conductivity over temperature. This graphic here shows how a typical LFA result looks like. So it's not a linear measurement, but every 100 degrees, we did a couple of measurements, and every 100 degrees, we formed the average value of these measurements, resulting in this curve. This curve shows the thermal conductivity, thermal diffusivity of an alumina magnesia mixed oxide ceramic, and it shows the typical behavior of ceramic, which means it has a slightly decreasing and then stabilizing thermal diffusivity, and also the thermal conductivity behaves pretty similar. This is how a typical ceramic measurement by LFA would look like. As I said, the LFA can also measure the heat capacity simultaneously. That means if you have a reference material available that's similar to your sample, that means for a ceramic, you need a ceramic reference with known specific heat, you can run both of them within the same measurement with the same settings. And out of the difference in the heat uptake and difference in the heat release, the system can evaluate the specific heat of your unknown sample by comparing it to a known reference. Out of that, you can directly within one measurement receive specific heat, which is shown as this light blue curve. You can receive thermal diffusivity and thermal conductivity. The only information the system requires is density, of course, and layer thickness. So this is a typical result. It's the same sample like on the slide before, so it's belonging to this one. But now you see specific heat and you see thermal conductivity at the same time. So this is what the LFA can more or less measure. One thing that's interesting, for most ceramics, thermal diffusivity and conductivity behave very similar. They are more or less decreasing in the same, by the same slope. And for some materials, especially semiconductors or inhomogeneous materials, please be aware that not always a decreasing thermal diffusivity means also decreasing thermal conductivity. It can behave completely different. And this is why it's so important to know both values. So the speed, how fast heat is transferred through material, can be much faster than the amount of heat that is transferred. So it can transport, for instance, a low amount of heat very fast or a high amount of heat very fast or very slowly. And therefore, thermal diffusivity and conductivity may be the same like for most ceramics, but can completely be different. The same thing, just that you have seen that for steels. This is a thermal diffusivity measurement of two different steel alloys. And just to show you, for steel, the thermal diffusivity is not decreasing so much, it's more or less constant, or constant in a very narrow range. And as said, steel is a combination of iron with carbon and other metals, and depending on the traces of carbon, traces of mangan, or traces of any other thing in there, the behavior can completely change. It means just small changes in the material mixture can lead to completely different thermal diffusivity and conductivity, what is shown here by measuring, just comparing two similar steels who are similar but not even identical. Again, the heat capacity and thermal conductivity were also determined. So heat capacity, you see, they are also a little bit different. And the thermal conductivity in this case behaves also similar to the diffusivity, which, as I said, is not always the case. Another special field of application would be an in-plane measurement. As I said, for some materials, it's different if you measure them through plane or in-plane. And if it's inhomogeneous, they can completely behave different. So in-plane and through-plane can completely behave different. To achieve an in-plane measurement, By LFA, we have basically two options. First of all, we have this adapter that you can see here. It's an adapter with a small hole at the bottom side and these four holes at the top side that forces the laser beam or the heat flow to go into the sample. Then it goes within the sample in plane, and then it's recorded at these small gaps here after a certain distance. And there's a special evaluation model you can select to get the in-plane value. And the other option is, like in that application example here, here we measure the graphite plate that was inhomogeneous. First of all, we measure through plane in the classic way, resulting in the through plane values, like you see with the light blue curve. And then we cut it into small lamella pieces and fix them in this lamella sample holder you can see in the picture up left. And then we measure it again. And as you see, the value of thermal diffusivity completely changed because of the inhomogeneity of the material. And as you see, there is a difference between in-plane and through-plane. And for some materials, it's important to know both values. So either you do that by a sample holder like this, or you do that by cutting the sample and use a sample holder like that. But both is possible, just that you be aware of that. Besides that, there's another special field, which is layer models. We offer an automatic evaluation of up to three layers if you measure a multi-layer model or multi-layer sample. The important thing is that usually your layers are on a substrate, and you need to know about your substrate. So usually you measure your blank substrate, then you know thermal conductivity, diffusivity of your substrate, and then you can measure the stack of substrate and layers. As you see here, we have measured the ceramic substrate, ceramic layer on an aluminum substrate. The aluminum alloy itself was measured first, and then the combined stack was measured to investigate the layer behavior. As you see, there is a step in the layer that's not displayed by the substrate, so this is really coming from the layer. And if you know about the thermal conductivity and diffusivity about your substrate, you can evaluate the layers or even two layers automatically by the right model. Just that you have seen that also this is possible. As said, CP, layer thickness and density of substrate and layer, of course, must be known, otherwise it's not possible. In that case, you have to know the CP of your layer material because you cannot evaluate the CP by LFA, which is important to know. And then, as last example, just that you have seen that, the LFA is the only technique. I showed you this overview at the beginning. The LFA is the only technique that is capable of measurement of very high conductivity materials. Most other methods like guarded hot plate or hot wire are limited at some range around 100, 150 watt per meter Kelvin. If you have materials like copper or highly conductive material alloys or even diamonds, the LFA is still able to measure them because the LFA has a high pulse energy, and the measurement range is only limited by the pulse range or by the energy range of the laser pulse. In these examples, we show you that we already measured successfully copper alloys, resulting in thermal diffusivity around 1.2, 1.3 square centimeters per second, and the thermal conductivity around 350 watt per meter Kelvin. And that's not even the upper end. We already measured diamond samples. We had a technical synthetical diamond disc from a drilling diamond that really showed thermal conductivity values, as you can see here, around really 1,000 watt per meter Kelvin. Of course, the layer thickness must be a little bit higher. So usually the LFA can measure a layer thickness down to around 200 microns. For such highly conductive materials, you should require or use a layer thickness of around 2 or 3 millimeters, like in that case. But if the layer is thick enough, you still are able to measure even if the conductivity is at the upper edge of the scale, just that you have seen that. Thank you so far. This is the presentation so far. At the end of the presentation, before I go to your questions, I want to show you a little bit about the software that you see that LFA measurement is not so difficult. It's just the sample preparation. The software itself as you can see here is not very complicated. The only thing what you really need to type in is more or less your sample thickness, and if you have it, the CP value. If you use a laser flash from Linzeiss, basically it's all about sample preparation, but once you have placed the sample in the instrument, you can just start a measurement with only a few settings. First of all, you have to select if you're doing in-plane, through-plane, or classic laser flash. In most cases, you will do classic laser flash. And then you can define iris and amplifier factors here. Iris and amplifier means the iris is the iris that is in front of the detector and is limiting or increasing the energy that the detector sees. And also the amplifier is, yeah, more or less amplifying the detector signal. However, it doesn't matter what you select here because the software will automatically optimize iris amplifier measurement time. The only thing, as I said, is if you already know your CP data by temperature or density by temperature, you can type them in here, or you can just use and link an Excel or ASCII table containing this information. If you don't have it, you don't need it. You can use any atmosphere, you type them here. Usually LFA is done in inert atmosphere or vacuum because of the graphite parts in there. At room temperature, you can use any atmosphere. You type in the file where the data shall be stored. And as I said, then you can choose which sample holder you have. For instance, if you have a 3x1-inch sample holder, you just need to type in a name of your sample, so the name of your material for each sample, which will be stored automatically, and the thickness of your sample, so the way the energy has to go through in centimeters. That's all you need. Then you start at a certain measurement time, iris and amplifying factor, no matter which one, because the system will automatically optimize that. Once you have done all these settings, you can just select laser shot and do a measurement, and you will get a pulse resulting in, yeah, more or less the thermal diffusivity value. Or you can also just program a heating profile and segments over here. You define at what temperature, how many shots shall be done, and then the system automatically does all the shots at all these temperatures, resulting in more or less these curves I have showed you in the presentation before. That's more or less all you need. Of course, you can do settings like you can increase your pulse duration or the laser pulse energy. That means you can define pulse length, pulse maximum, and therefore the energy, how much energy you want to bring to the sample. But as an unexperienced user, you just can operate with this one side here. You do this, you do laser shot, then the system after the shot will automatically go to evaluation and directly show you your result and give you your thermal diffusivity, and if you have CP data, thermal conductivity. The only thing I want to mention is here you can select which model should be used for evaluation. And as I said, we recommend this combined model, which is quite kind of universal. And besides that, there are a lot of known other models where you find some literature for it, like heat loss, radiation, multi-layer, in-plane model, two-layer, and three-layer models. And that's more or less all you need to do. So no complex evaluation software. As I said, the value is given directly as a number. No complex curve evaluation because it's done automatically. And not much playing around with the settings as the software is automatically optimizing the settings. As said, the more or less critical part for the LFA is always the sample preparation. As I said, the sample has to be homogeneous thickness, flat, fitting exactly into your sample holder. That's the reason why we have so many different sample holders. And the sample also have to be coated by a graphite layer. Because you want to make sure that the laser pulse is completely taken up by your sample and the detector sees always the same kind of surface and always the same kind of infrared irradiation from the surface. So far about the presentation. Thank you for your attention.